it's time to explore together the wonderful world of GraphQL and REST. Let's take a look at what GraphQL is, what REST is, and when you should choose one over the other. What is the need that they exist to serve? Why and how should you use them? And we'll see the four advantages that GraphQL has over the RESTful style of APIs. And then the two major disadvantages that you have to watch out for if you use or create an API in GraphQL. But before that, let's start at the beginning. What is GraphQL? GraphQL is a way of creating web APIs. I've already made a video talking about APIs in general and REST web APIs in particular. REST is a standard way of organizing an API, but GraphQL is challenging that position of dominance. To understand GraphQL and to understand why it exists, I'll be comparing it with the way REST APIs are organized, because GraphQL is in part a response to the problems that REST has. But before I do that, allow me to introduce myself. My name is David, and coding is a passion to me. Helping people understand code and technology is a passion. So if you find this video useful, please let me know. Please send a signal to the YouTube algorithm by using that like button. In fact, GraphQL exists because of likes and the whole concept of subscribing to someone or to something. Because GraphQL was born at Facebook. It was built to meet a need specific to social networks, a problem that the like button itself embodies. Let me explain. GraphQL's main purpose is to navigate a relational network. What do I mean by that? RESTful APIs are particularly suited to a traditional table-based database setup, where each row represents an object, and we need to read or set that object's state, data. After all, REST stands for Representational State Transfer. But to state things differently, REST's purpose is to communicate an item or several items of a collection or a table in a database. In REST terms, these are called resources and resource collections. We ask the server to send us the data for a given book or a collection of books, for example. But Facebook and social networks in general are about the relationship between things rather than simply the things themselves. Who are my friends' friends? What content do they like? What do they respond to? Friendships, follows, or likes are relationships between different types of entities. These relationships combined form a graph with nodes and with links. GraphQL's purpose is to traverse this graph across different types of objects. Unlike REST, where one request will usually only get one type of item. That's the meaning of GraphQL, which stands for Graph Query Language. Unlike REST, GraphQL really is a query language in the way that the structured query languages, which you might better know under the name of SQL. In REST, the entry point you call and the HTTP verb you use determine a server's response. In GraphQL, you only talk to one entry point. You do so by sending an HTTP request that contains a page of text of code, which is written in GraphQL. And based on that GraphQL code, the server responds. These requests are mainly of two types. You can send a read request, known as a query, or a write request, known as a mutation. In these requests, we list all the fields we want in the response. For example, in the Star Wars API, we can send the following read requests that you can see on the screen. Here we ask for the data pertaining to the hero, and we want to know his ID and his name. And as everyone knows, as you can see, the hero in Star Wars is R2-D2, obviously. And here we can see GraphQL's second advantage. We define on the client side the shape we want the data to take. Why? Well, for mobile users in particular, but on the web in general, the amount of data sent has a cost in time, in bandwidth, and in interactivity. Now let's take this example a little further. As I mentioned earlier, we can browse the links of the relational graph in the same query. Here in this example, we can retrieve the hero's friends by specifying the fields we want to have in the return. Here we get the hero's friends, their IDs, and their names. And as you can see, when I type the code in the editor, which is a GraphQL playground, it gives me suggestions. If I open this tab here on the right, I have the documentation. The reason this is possible is because of introspection. which is GraphQL's third advantage. What is introspection? Well, GraphQL has a very special feature. It has default queries, which document through GraphQL itself which fields and which queries are supported. And that's built into GraphQL, built into the specification. The editor uses this query to create its suggestions. So for example, if I send the following query with the schema, and I request the query type and the fields, and then I request the name, the type, and then within the type, I request the kind and the name. Here we can see that this returns a list of possible queries on the root node, including the hero request that we used previously. And this feature is a response to one of REST's biggest flaws. You need an external documentation to use it. And as a rule, external documentation is error-prone, incomplete, and out of date. Of course, there have been attempts to create self-documenting formats in REST, but none of them have taken hold because REST doesn't have a standardized implementation. In fact, REST is more of a recommendation than a specification. Whereas in Graph, self-documentation is part of the specification. It comes baked into the protocol. Now, let's talk about types. If we go back to our previous query, we can see that the introspective query, as well as the documentation tab, present the return values for each query. In GraphQL, things have a type. Strong typing is GraphQL's fourth advantage. GraphQL answers the question, what are the different types in our API? How do they work? What shape do they have? Types are a natural fit with GraphQL's introspection. If we run the following query, where we request the schema, the types, the kind name, when we look at the response, when we look through the list, you'll see different types of things. We'll see scalar types. These are the basic types. There are five of them. There are strings, booleans, ints, floats, and the ID, which can actually be a string or an integer. If you go through the documentation, you'll see two more notations, the exclamation mark and the square brackets. The square brackets means what is returned is actually a list of the things of the type within the bracket. And the exclamation mark means that the thing can't be null. Then we also see specific composite types like human or droid. And again, we can use introspection to see these objects' shape. This is also an opportunity to see how we can pass parameters in GraphQL. We'll be using the type query with the name set to human. And we query the fields of the object and we get their types. Here we see we can automatically retrieve object types directly from the GraphQL API. GraphQL's strong typing works well with TypeScript and type languages in general. Now, we've seen four major advantages that GraphQL has over REST, namely the ability to query a relational graph, being able to shape the data client-side, introspection, and types. But not everything is rosy, and GraphQL's strengths come with weaknesses attached. First, the fact that the client defines the shape of the data means that caching and optimizing queries is difficult. The second problem is even more troublesome. This is known as the N+1 problem, and it's due to GraphQL letting the client decide how complex the query is. The client can, if it so wishes, and the server doesn't have any additional configuration, run absolutely all the queries within a single request. In itself, that's not that much of an issue because the complexity remains fairly linear. The real concern is that when searching deep into the graph, the complexity grows exponentially. What do I mean by that? Well, by default, there's nothing in GraphQL to prevent me from looking for my friends, 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 and so on. Nothing except for the fact that it would bring the server down to its knees. It then becomes the responsibility of the front-end developer, the one working on the client side, to think about not overloading the database. And that, to me, is a terrifying prospect. Thankfully, some implementations can block this level of nesting, and GraphQL's advantages, notably typing and self-documentation through inspection, result in a far superior developer experience by providing documentation and a playground that allows you to test out the APIs. And that makes a smoother, more fluid experience and means that GraphQL is more fun. And if you're a regular on this channel, you know that I'm passionate about understanding what makes code fun. And if you're not yet a regular, but that you've made it this far in the video, well, now is the time to put all this into practice and to create one of these links that graphs are made of by liking this video or by subscribing or by watching the next video.